to interact with. So when we're using words that relate to mental and emotional concepts, like thoughts, desires, beliefs, and feelings, it can be positively associated with the social emotional development of these children. So thinking about shared book reading, it is associated with increased mental and emotional state talk. So shared book reading can be used to support a lot of different learning activities. So for our study, we were looking at increasing the mental and emotional state talk. It can be a useful and effective intervention for using that book as a vehicle to help preschoolers understand and develop their skills. And so when we're talking about those skills, it can be listening, self-control, self-regulation, friendships, solving those social problems on their own. And then again, identifying their own and others' emotions. And then there's those more difficult or stronger emotions like anger, and understanding that along with this pro-social understanding and showing empathy. And so children's ability to recognize and understand this information sets the foundation for later social and academic success. So thinking about peer relationships, their behavior in the classroom, adjusting to school. There's a big adjustment between preschool to kindergarten, for example, and just even pre-literacy skills. And so children with social emotional difficulties in preschool are more likely, you know, to experience some behavior problems, might have trouble transitioning, expressing their feelings, problem solving, and that can impact social interactions and academic difficulties. So shared reading. So the adult reads to the child, and it is a planned interactive technique. You're asking questions, you're giving explanations, you're prompting or asking the child to answer specific questions. And it's helpful because you can encourage child responses, and that can include spontaneous initiations, and then giving feedback, modeling the language, giving children opportunity to use this language and learn information. And then more specifically, a type of shared reading is dialogic reading. And so peer is a scaffolding step. So prompting the question, evaluating the child's response, expanding on the response and asking them to repeat it. And so there's crowd, which are the question types. So the P in peer. And so there's a lot of different questions. There's completion, recall, open-ended questions, WH, and distancing. And then there can be question levels. So for example, question level 1, 2, and 3. So, and they get more complex. Okay. So we know that shared reading, can be beneficial and it's appropriate for preschool, but as far as using shared reading to promote children's social emotional competence, it's been more minimally explored. So here there's just a couple different studies that looked at using storybooks and focusing on the characters' mental states. And overall, it's been helpful to teach children about social emotional skills and understanding and development. So that's the overall gist here. A lot of the studies that were reviewed here were geared more towards parents and caregivers and one-to-one interactions, but preschool is an important place for social emotional learning. And, you know, book reading is typically part of every preschool day as well. So there's ways to integrate that. Okay. So the purpose of this study was to examine the benefits of the use of shared reading in a social emotional context, specifically when teaching preschool children. And, our research question is, what is the effect of a shared reading routine on the social emotional vocabulary knowledge of preschool children? And so looking at that, we go to our methods. So we did a single case, multiple probe across word sets, and I'll explain a little bit more about that. Our dependent variable was knowledge of our target vocabulary as measured by probes, but we also had instructional sessions during intervention that measured the knowledge of the target vocabulary during reading. And we use visual analysis to then decide if it was appropriate to then probe. Okay, so talking about our participant recruitment and language screening. So we recruited from local childcare centers. We recruited all children and we didn't have, so previous studies that we've done have been with children at risk or with language delays. So we were, that was not, we were looking at all children. And so we had 6 participants that had consented and we did a language screening. We did the self 2. There's a self 3, but we did the self 2 because that's what we had and it was for research purposes. So that was okay. And so we just wanted to have some information on where the children's language was falling. And then we had a baseline probe that determined the words taught. We randomized the words to create word sets. The children read 1 storybook with the interventionist per session. And there was a shared reading, a very specific script, and we had scaffolding and then coding, inter-observer agreement and procedural fidelity. So I'll go into that a little bit more of more visuals there. Okay. So this is an example. So Dr. Dennis had found there was this word list that was appropriate for preschoolers and it was social emotional. And we looked at these words, looked at books that we could possibly use for these words. And then the children were screened on their knowledge of these words. And so there's the green was included from the screening that the child did not know at all. This was Nick, pseudonym, of course. And then there was the possibles and then excluded. So some of the other participants might have had a couple excluded, but I just use Nick's as an example. So this is how we were determining what words they maybe did or didn't know. And then thinking about what would really be most appropriate for the preschoolers, because some of these were a little, possibly a little more complicated, because this list, Dr. Dennis, did this list go, it wasn't preschool specific, right?
I think we initially, we looked at Baron Cohen's article and selected words from there initially. So that was our first sort of pass through. And then from there, we narrowed it down to books that we, or words that we could find books mm-hmm. to target those specific words. And I think that's how we got down to this final list, if I remember correctly.
Right. Yes.
And the words, yes. And we pulled from, an article, Glenn Dunlap suggested these specific emotion words that were more geared for typically developing kiddos because they are a little bit more challenging than your typical glad, mad, sad types of emotion words that you would typically see with preschool children. So we were trying to level up just a little bit with the complexity in terms of the emotion vocabulary. So that's why another reason why we selected these words.
Yes, thank you. Okay. And so this is an example. So we had 6, we ended up, we had attrition. And so we had 4 of that finished, or are finishing. But so these were our words and we did make some decisions about some words that shouldn't be in the same word set together because they were too similar. And then you can see how we randomized them for set 1, 2, and 3. And then every child learned different words at different word sets. So it was additionally randomized in that way so that they were all learning different words, different word sets, completely differently from each other, the combinations. And so this was our words and the books that were read with it. So that is that example there. And then So thinking about our probe sessions, so once we determined our, you know, we had our words and our word sets and our randomized vocabulary words for each child, each participant, we probed. And so we had our baseline probes, and then we had our instructional sessions, which I'll talk about. And then, you know, we probed each time before going on to the next word set. And so for probe sessions, we would say, what is this person feeling? And so hopefully they would say, this is a real one. And so I picked one where they got it right. They said in Paris. We got some very unique responses sometimes. Or sometimes they would just try to describe the picture, like the boy dropped his ice cream. And we're like, but okay, but what is he feeling? And so helping them kind of giving them that little prompt to remind them to talk about what the child's feeling. So our probe sessions looked like that. We ended up doing, so we had our pictures for the instruction, which I'll talk about in a second. But what we ended up doing was we had different pictures for the probe, and they were getting, they didn't know. They weren't generalizing it. Really. So what we did is to see if it made a difference. We still asked them all the probe questions for this, for the EID, the definition. But what we also did was we added the instruction pictures. So we had the original probe pictures that we were trying to see if they were generalized a different picture and be able to say what the emotion was. But then we also used the instruction pictures that they saw during instruction and asked them as well to see if that helped at all. Okay, so, and then we did probe sessions. So this is, we did inference to self and inference to others. And so what would you be doing if you were, and then it's whatever the word is, like, for example, determined, and then how could you help someone else be determined? So inference to others. And so this is what the probe sessions looked like. And we scaffolded. So I'll talk about that when I talk about the instruction, but that's the 1, 2, 3. I'll talk about that in the next slide, what that means. Okay, here it is. So what we did was we started in probe 2 to start, we added scaffolding. As a team, we got together and we talked about the difficulties that the students were having with the probe sessions and what we were going to do. So what we ended up doing is we added this additional script, where you're asking the question prompt, as it was written. And then if correct, you give that feedback for working hard, working their brain. And then, but if they said, I don't know, then we would show the picture for whether it's inference to self or inference to others, to help them with that visual picture cue, basically, and remind them that they can refer to the picture. And you ask the question prompt again. If correct, again, feedback for working hard. And if not, we went to binary choice. So that was a scaffolding that we integrated starting in probe 2. And then it varied by participant, where we started with least to most prompting, basically, where we had like our business as usual, where it was just the EID picture. This boy is determined. He's, and then give the definition of determined. And then we would read the book for instruction. And then we would add the inference to others and inference to self pictures was the next level. And that's for instructional sessions. And then what we did was we added the binary choice. So they didn't all get to binary choice, but that's kind of how we would make team decisions based on how they were doing. And then we marked it where we started doing that so we could talk about it and remember where we changed things. So for the instructional sessions, this is an example of the script that for grumpy monkey. And so when they're talking about the word grumpy, we'd have the children say the word, child-friendly definition, the picture cards that I mentioned for definition, inference to self and inference to others, and keep the picture card out. And then ask the child, put your thumb up when you hear or see the picture of the word grumpy. That wasn't measure, but that just was another kid-friendly way to get them to engage and interact and listen for the word grumpy. And so this is an example of the prompts, and our interventionists had them post-it noted or had this sheet, depending on what their preference was, to read. And okay. And so what we did was, I just took a screenshot. We use Mosaic. And so I just wanted to, so we had these, the rubric, which I think is on the next slide. Let's do this first. So we just did 0 or 1 based on the question type, and we had their criterion. And here's some sample responses. Some of them were clear cut, and some of them we had a lot of team decisions on thinking about if it was a 1-point response or not. Some kids got really stuck on certain responses that could be appropriate, but it wasn't really necessarily demonstrating the knowledge of the word. It was just this memorized phrase that they would just give us. Okay, so I coded child level. So I've watched every single video for every single child. And so we have the, I would just write the EID. So the definition, the inference to self, and inference to others. And then we had a few people measuring probe and intervention fidelity. And so I just screen grabbed the intervention fidelity to kind of just let you see kind of how they were, what they were looking at and rating. So, okay, we're doing on time. Okay, thinking about the results. So I mentioned we started with 6 children, but we had attrition for 2. One moved and one, it became, he was refusing to participate, and maybe it became more that he was distressed and it wasn't beneficial for him to be pulled from the classroom. Social validity will be collected. So the study isn't totally over. It'll be over hopefully in the next week. We'll get our probes for the last 2 kids. And then we'll be done. We're on the last probe. The intervention instructional sessions have been completed. But then we're going to collect social validity from a variety of stakeholders. So teachers, the children's parents, and then the directors of the schools. So all they were all at one school and then one switch school. So we might be able to get some information from more than one director. And so we're collecting still our IOA and procedural fidelity for 20% of the session. So that's, the study is in progress. So, okay, I'm going to talk about, so this, let me tell you what you're looking at here. This is Nick. Now he had the full, first, okay. So the way we graph this is the definition questions, the EID are the circles. And then their responses to inference to self and inference to other were graphed as one data point. We added up the points and got that percentage for those responses. And that's how we graphed that. And that's the squares. So there was a lot of overlap, for example, in word set 1, you know, he had, oops, zeros. But that's, that you're looking at a square and a circle overlap there. So you can see we probed and then we did our instruction and measuring that. And then we probed again across all 3 and then moved to word set 2 and so on. And it was very variable for a lot of different reasons. Nick was our only child who actually scored lower on the language scale. And so I would really consider him actually at risk for language delays. We went pretty quickly to scaffolding for him, as far as providing the visual EID picture, and then the inference to self and inference to other, the IS and IO picture, and then doing the binary choice. And that really helped him. And what was really exciting about him was he gave us a lot of I don't knows in the beginning. And by the third word set, he was giving us responses. And he wasn't using his binary. It was available, but he was giving us responses. And so you could see his growth and confidence in what he was learning and being able to respond to the interventionist questions. So that was really exciting to see that he didn't really need his scaffolding as much towards the end. Let's see. That is Nick. So you can see we taught the three words for each word set and moved on. And then Ryan. So we have also, we have Wendy and Sam. They just weren't finished yet, but Ryan and Nick had finished. So I have those two graphs. So Ryan would, she, so all the participants had all three levels of scaffolding for their probes by when we started by probe two, when we figured out that that's what we were going to do. She only ended up, let's see, I have it written down so I won't forget. She moved to the picture cues that she added instead of just for the definition. She had the IO and IS, and she started that in word set one. IV4. So intervention session one and word set one is when she started with that. So you can see it's also kind of variable, but she showed a lot of knowledge during instructional. It was still a little variable, but she kind of struggled on the probes. Some of that might have been a little bit because of behavior. It's also kind of challenging. And when you take the book away, and asking them these questions that are, might be, so when the book is there, they were able to answer the questions pretty well, but when you take it away, it was a little bit harder for the probes. So that's Ryan. Okay, so thinking about implications for research. So for the future, we want to think about teacher implemented or caregiver implemented interventions, as far as different ways to approach this, as far with those picture examples, maybe if we had more examples, whether or not we're using some more technology on an iPad with different pictures and examples of those emotion words, because again, sometimes they would get stuck on the pictures that we had because they were trying to describe what the kid was doing versus what they were feeling. Hoping that teachers could use this in a group setting as classroom routine. This, I don't know, Dr. Nurse, you want to talk about what rebound and recovery is kind of how this came a little bit adapted from.
Yeah, so through the College of Social Work, we actually have a doc student that joined our special education program this summer, Ty Cole. I think she's here. Ty, are you here?
Yes, I am.
Hi, Ty. Can you share a little bit about, so we adapted what we were doing here from a curriculum that Ty and some colleagues, well, Ty and others have developed and sort of attempted to disseminate throughout Leon County and other places in Florida. And so maybe she can tell you, if you wouldn't mind sharing a little bit about sort of where we started with this project, if you wouldn't mind.
So Rebound and Recovery was developed out of actually Hurricane Michael, when we were asked to go into Bay County to help with students dealing with that trauma. And so there just wasn't enough of a curriculum out there to address what they were doing. So we developed this curriculum to help in those situations, but then found that there was a broader use for it. And so Rebound and Recovery is a cognitive behavioral intervention that uses art therapy, play therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, and mindfulness skills to help children understand the connection between their thoughts, feelings, and their emotions. And there's 10 sessions of it that teach the children these language skills. So each of the sessions is focusing on a particular emotion, and it uses a reading. It uses hands-on activities that they do. And by the time they finish the program, they understand, hopefully, the connection that they have whenever they're either happy or sad to the behavior that they're experiencing, and also the thoughts that are occurring. And we also go over like what maladaptive thoughts are. We don't use that word for the little ones, but and so we also teach them the mindfulness skills. So by the time they're done, there is an actual toolbox and a kit for them to use. And one of the reasons we created it for educators was because that was one of the basic problems that was out there with any curriculum that did exist, is that you either had to be screened in for the intervention, or it had to be a clinician-led intervention for a child to receive it. And we wanted every child to be able to receive this.
Thank you, Ty. Yeah, so she, we connected and were able to develop just a portion to evaluate child level outcomes on rebound and recovery. And so we picked the shared book reading component as a sort of our first step. We're hoping to replicate and move forward with future studies with this, but Ty and her colleagues were the ones that sort of brought this idea to us, and we took it and ran with it. So thank you, Ty.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Ty. Yeah, so that's kind of where this started to come from. And so then also, Dr. Nose touched on this a little, just briefly, how, you know, we want to replicate this and use what we've learned. Some of the limitations are based on the probe and how we're measuring their knowledge, because you could see in instruction, they were able to answer questions pretty well, but then with the probes, once you're just asking them questions with really no visuals after, you know, you had your definition pictures, what is this person feeling? But then when you're asking, the inference of self and others without any visuals, it was really hard. And so we were thinking about what that means for next steps. Well, next steps might be also to replicate this with children at risk for language delays. We were able to do this with mostly typically developing children. So maybe looking at children more at risk for language delays, probably have to consider our words maybe a little bit, if going that route, and then doing the scaffolding that we've developed from the start, and then thinking about how we're assessing their knowledge in the probes too, just how we ask them the questions. We've been thinking about, and I have to read more about it, but if anyone's familiar with dynamic assessment, and thinking about what that means potentially for how we're going to do this. So that is kind of where we're at here. And then on to questions. And real quick, thank you. And those are my children. So I'm going to stop sharing for now and answer any questions if there are any.
That's 35 minutes so far.
Yeah, thank you, Taryn. So yeah, we have about 25 minutes to engage in question and discussion. If anyone has anything, you can unmute and share, or if you want to drop it in the chat, I'll monitor that component of it so that we can make sure Dr. Wade can see. Although I think you can see it now that you're not screen sharing, but I'll let you know if anything pops up in the chat.
Okay.
And the School of Teacher Education.
I'll ask a question, Dr. Wade. I couldn't figure out how to raise my hand. I used to know how to do that. but I've been thinking, I was doing some reading earlier this week about just social validity in general, and kind of how important social validity is, especially in intervention work, and how we should be using, like how we are using social validity and how we really should be using social validity. So for those of you who are not familiar with that term, it essentially is evaluating and assessing the extent to which what we are doing is acceptable or meaningful to the consumers. So basically consumer satisfaction, right? And then consumers oftentimes are conceptualized broadly. So, you know, one consumer is the actual students that are partaking in the intervention, be the teachers, it could be, you know, the family members who might be impacted or benefit from the intervention. So my first question is, and forgive me if you did mention this, but did you do any assessments of social validity in terms of, do people think that this is important, right? Do they think that your procedures are something that would be feasible in a school setting?
Really defense at the moment.
So we will be doing that as soon as we're done collecting those final probes. And so our plan is to talk to the child care center director, especially the one child care center that we use because the director was in the room as sort of that extra adult that was their policy. And so not only just generally asking her, but she was able to see the intervention in action many times across different students. And then the children are really young. I guess we could ask them what they thought. For my dissertation, I worked with preschool children too, and I focused more on the adults, less so on the 3 and 4 year olds. Cause I'm thinking that they'll probably just be say like, it was fine. Or like, I like the stickers. I mean, I guess it's valuable, but, and then the teachers too, I'm getting their input. We haven't developed our questions yet, but kind of pulling from my dissertation because it was a different vocabulary, but similar kind of intervention. I was asking the teachers if they heard the kids using more. Mine was shape vocabulary, so more shape words. Did they think my questions were too easy, too hard, or just right? I asked them if they had suggestions for improvement, because I let them, I put on a USB drive some the recordings from Mosaic of their students, and then they watched it so that they could actually see what I was doing. And then, yeah, so I asked for any information for improvement, or could they see them using this in their classroom? So that's kind of what I was getting at with the teachers. And I would guess we're kind of going to go a similar route to an extent, but go more in depth and get more perspectives as far as hopefully access to the parents. I didn't have, for my dissertation, I didn't have access to the parents for different reasons, just school procedure. But I believe we'll have access to these parents. And then, right, Dr. Dennis, I think we will.
Yeah, so the plan at this point is to have similar, sets of questions for the assistant director at the child care center and the parents and the teachers. I actually was able to talk with Nick's mom, whose data we were looking at previously after the intervention was over, and he was the one that we screened with a self that was quite low. And as Taryn said, if this were, you know, her performing this self-assessment with this kiddo, I'm sure he would have been referred. He was actually going into kindergarten, has started kindergarten. But she was very thankful for him being able to participate. She said anecdotally, she noticed that he had improved his vocabulary over the course of the time that he spent in the study. He was in that COVID bubble. And so he was at home with her for a year and didn't have much interaction with other kids. He's a single kiddo. And so I was really happy to talk to her and get that feedback, but we're going to develop something that's more specific, obviously has something that we can use to, you know, compare between sort of how administrators view the importance of social emotional learning and what that should look like in the classroom, how teachers see that, what do they think is important, how do they, you know, how can they support our learners? And then also for parents, you know, what do they think their role is? What is the importance of that sort of thing? So it's in progress. Dr. Flory, open to suggestions if you have any.
Well, no, and I would actually love to like sit down and kind of pick your brains. This is, our lab is also working on being better about how we're assessing social validity, because normally we do it after the fact, right? Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, okay, you've done the intervention, let's have people at this rating form.
Right.
Which again, you know, it's better than nothing, but ideally, right, we'd be using focus groups initially to first refine our intervention. So it's likely to be have buy-in, right? And then afterwards, but we actually, you know, we're also working with preschool students, and that's hard too, but they are the direct consumers of it, right? So we, in our lab, we've been talking a lot about, well, how are other ways that we can think about our children actually enjoying this, right? And so it could be things like looking at their engagement during the reading, right? Even asking them, did you like this book, right? Or out of these books that we read, which one was your favorite, right? But to get a sense of, you know, even though we might have the most effective intervention, if people don't like doing it, they're not going to do it, right? If the kids are walking away, right? Or you're having to withdraw kids because of behavioral issues, you know, that could also be, you know, an indication of the social validity of it and things that we might need to think about changing.
Of course. And I totally agree. And I think too, that there's especially with this age group, there comes a point when they're just done. And I think they are just done with us. There's some kids who I think would read with us forever. And I think just hearing Danielle, if you're here, she's one of our interventionists. And so I know that she knows firsthand. She shows up and they're like, really? We're reading this book again, huh? You know, it's kind of like, and so they're just the time that it's taken us. And that's part of the nature of collecting data over the summer, which is a bad idea. And I shouldn't have done that, but here we were, because that's what we had access to. And, you know, having absences and other things that sort of interfered with that. And so it's taken a lot longer than we anticipated. But I just think at this point they are, they're just kind of over it. But I think you're right. That would
be interesting. They told us, they would tell us, you know, well, not, I watched the videos. They weren't telling me, they were telling Danielle and Cassidy, but whether or not they like books. And what Dr. Dennis was saying, they kind of get over it after a while. Like for my dissertation, I had awesome stamps and tons of stickers. And by the end, they're like, at least one kid was like, I don't want any stamps or stickers. I just want to go back to class. Like in their three-year-old way of expressing that, they're just like, I don't want stamps. Like, okay. So it gets to a point, but they'll tell you. I feel like they'll tell you when they like books and when they didn't, almost like as soon as you pulled it out. And then I had ones, they would like the books, but mine too, when you're reading the same book. So we're on a 3-book rotation. My dissertation was a 5-book rotation. And even with 5 books, they'd be like, by the time I would read the 4 and then like book 1 would come around again. They're like, we already read this. I'm like, yeah, I know. We're going to read it again. So it's interesting. You're limited for the social emotional vocabulary. There's some limits, I think. When I was thinking about my shape vocabulary, I probably could have used in the future. I could probably change the book every single time because you can get real creative when you're just looking at basic shapes, I think, but it's interesting. Yes, Dr. Whalen.
I just wanted to follow up. Wait, am I muted?
No, you're not. Now you are.
Oh. I just had a, you know, with social validity too, I think sometimes we focus on if they like it too much. Like, I mean, I think liking it is important, right? But I mean, it's also important if the outcome's meaningful. So I think a lot about vocabulary and when we, because I do some of this work too. And when we think about vocabulary, like, I think it's a hard thing to measure. Mm-hmm. And because we're not just looking at like, can you identify something? We want to know if they really have depth of understanding of words. Like that's the part that we want to see. And it can be really challenging to get. So I think, you know, that's an area I think the field really has to kind of work on is, you know, and even at these young ages, what does that look like? What does depth of understanding look like? And so are they using the word is one indicator, right? Like, so when they're playing, do they talk about their feelings? Or when they're at other parts of the day, do they talk about their feelings? And so, you know, I think I use single case too, so I'm not going to just, and you're all, many of you are going to take single case in the spring, and it has a lot of really good qualities, but one of the things that where I find it very limiting is it's a minimal context, right? And so I think one of the things is what we're teaching in this one single context, we need to be trying to figure out ways to broaden our social validity that goes beyond that context of outcome. So not just like, did you like, you know, was it, did you enjoy? Because a lot of kids are going to say yes on one day and no on another, but then it's like, do they really, did they really gain from it? Did they really benefit? Was the outcome something that was meaningful and relevant to their lives? And I think that's the part that especially in single case, we're kind of missing a bit. But I think it's true of group too sometimes. like sometimes it's a particular measure, right? But does that have a really socially valid impact in their day-to-day life? But I do think sometimes we have to do that through measurement and not just asking questions. Like we have to be able to try to find a way to get it.
Yeah. Yeah, it would have been nice to ask to try and track throughout their day if parents and or teachers noticed their use of, you know, that sort of thing. But this just wasn't something we built into this particular study, but it certainly would be interesting to do.
I think the drawback is then they know the words we're teaching and mm-hmm. then they might use them more, and we're probing across all word sets. So if you're like, hey, did they use the word grumpy today? And then that's on the parent and teacher's radar to use grumpy more. And so is what we, if they're improving in grumpy, is it because of what our intervention or because of these outside external factors of using the word grumpy more?
Yeah, I think it's a measurement issue. Yeah. Like, I think it's an important thing to do, but we've got to try to find ways to actually capture it and mm-hmm. capture it accurately. Mm-hmm.
Questions that folks have at this point? And Denise, I saw your comment about coding for sociability, the children's comments. That might be something, if they were captured on video, I don't know if they always were, but sometimes I'm sure they were.
Like as in what they're saying about the books and their uh-huh. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, I've watched every single video and they have opinions. I mean, Danielle knows firsthand, and like I said, our other interventionist, Cassidy, and then Ty codes procedural fidelity, so she's watched all the videos.
They love Grumpy Monkey.
Grumpy Monkey's a hit.
Yeah,
Danielle said they definitely share their opinions, yep.
But, you know, some of them, for example, we found a book, just finding books that teach emotion vocabulary in a developmentally appropriate way was very difficult to do. And so we were somewhat limited in the books we were able to select. So, for example, we found one that was The Embarrassed Unicorn, and he was embarrassed because he was farting. And we initially thought, well, this is funny. The kids will enjoy it, you know, that sort of thing. And it turned out there was a couple of kids who were like, I don't get it. I mean, why is he embarrassed?
It was a little nuanced for Nick.
Yes. And they didn't see that. It just was not funny to them. We thought it would be great. And there are very few books that teach about being embarrassed. And so that one was kind of on our part, but yeah, just, it was challenging to find those books, needless to say. Jenny, I see your hand up, and then Sin, it looks like there's a couple folks that have their hands up.
Yes. Can you guys hear me? Okay.
Yes. Yes.
I'm currently working on, with my advisor's lab, a single case project with typically developing toddlers as well. And I was wondering what kind of affected your decision to work with these typically developing children in a single case design versus a group design, and what your decision-making process was around that.
Well, we do single case research, and I think that was the main reason. I don't do group research. I don't know, Dr. Ennis, you have a more professorial, like,
well, I mean, yeah,
besides, you just don't do it.
Well, initially, because this was an area that I had not yet pursued with emotion vocabulary specifically and single case design, and there's not a lot of literature out there in that particular context, I thought, well, using typically developing kids would probably be a good place to start. And the words that we chose were, and I said Glenn Dunlap earlier, but that was incorrect. It's Phil Strain. They published a couple of articles about or suggestions for emotion and vocabulary for kids between the ages of 3 and 5, but they suggested that they kids be typically developing because the words were more challenging, they're a little bit more abstract, that sort of thing. And so that's why we targeted the population that we did. I think there would be ways to teach these vocabulary words to kids with language delays or other disabilities. It's just not something that we have, that we've fully thought through at this point, but definitely would like to consider moving forward. So.
Okay, thank you so much.
You're welcome. And Sen, you had your hand up?
Yeah, let me show myself. Okay, thanks so much for sharing your wonderful study, Taryn. I studied shared book reading too. And I believe one of the impacts of the shared book reading is to help the children understand and express their social emotion. I'm curious about the result. So do you think the words the children learned in the book could be related to their own experience? If the book or the word is more related, like have more connections to their life, the children tend to get this kind of words easier. For example, grumpy, the words grumpy versus determined versus embarrassed. Maybe for the young children, they do not understand what is embarrassing. I have never been embarrassed by anybody else. But another example, for example, the child has a grumpy grandfather. So I say, oh, the father is always mad. But then this kind of book activated the child experience. Like, oh, my grandfather is grumpy too. So yeah, this is basically my question. So I could, but I don't know how to measure that. Sorry. Yeah, that's my question.
I understand. So I would guess there were definitely some words that certain children got more readily than others, and it could be because of previous experience that would be harder for us to measure, or engagement and love of particular books that we read. Not saying they've read them before, but they just enjoyed them. And so we're more, maybe some of it is in, besides connection to previous experience, it might also be engagement in the storybook as well, potentially. Because I'm thinking back, even Dr. Ennis, our PD studies, and some of the books that are longer can be kind of tough. And also like Pout Pout Fish from PD 1.0 or 2.0 was like a long book. It's a little bit boring for the kids that we had. And so they just started to check out. And so I think you bring up a really good point, Sen, about, I'm sure there were some words that they've heard before versus others. And maybe it, like you said, activated it, or they caught it earlier because we screened. So they weren't able to tell us, tried to choose words, obviously, that they didn't know, but that's not to say that they can pick them up more easily, because maybe they hear them, or maybe they have a sibling who has anxiety and they hear the word anxious, and they hear the parent talking about to the sibling about feeling anxious. And so you make a good point. I think it's hard to measure that and like know why they may have gotten some words easier than others. That's definitely something to consider.
Thank you.
So any other last minute questions or comments for Dr. Wade? Well, if anybody solves the vocabulary measurement conundrum, let us know. Inquiring minds want to know. Okay. I don't know, Taryn, do you want to drop your email address in the chat just in case someone wants to reach out after the fact if they have other questions?
Sure.
Thank you, Dr. Wade, for sharing your research. And we look forward to the November talk, which will be with Dr. Michael Tuttle. He is in the visual disabilities program, so he'll be with us next month. And I apologize for the snafu with the Eventbrite link and the Zoom link. I think it got copied over from September, so it was no longer active. So we'll double check that for next time to make sure that we don't have that issue. So I really apologize for folks that had a hard time getting into the Zoom. So thank you again, everyone. I hope everyone has a lovely weekend, and we'll see you next month. Thanks, Dr. Whalen, for filling in. 'Good job, Taryn.
Thanks. I think Denise asked if she could have if there is access to the book list.
Who?
Denise.
Denise did. Oh, of course. Yeah. She can do it. Yeah.
I'll send it to her.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. Okay. Did anyone else have any last questions or anything? No. Okay. You know what? Let me stop recording because I didn't. Sorry about that. That tripped you up. I. Did you?